Thank you to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Hey, hey, Marcus House with you here, and once again, I've put together another midweek video for you all to enjoy. Today, we are going to take a close look into how SpaceX manages Starship pressurization and engine startups. We will also peer into the past to see where those solutions were used in previous generations of launches. Are you ready for this? Because we are about to go straight into the deep end of the pool. Join me here and let's dive right in.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
So we will start off here with what many of you would find the most familiar, that being SpaceX's Starship. This vehicle, once in later stages in development, will be kept pressed in flight by using what's called autogenous pressurization. But before we get into that, we need to go over some necessary background. Starship's Raptor engines run using two propellants, the fuel liquid methane and the oxidizer liquid oxygen. Remember these for later on. Now, both of these propellants can be viably produced on Mars through a chemical process known as the Sabatier reaction, which we've covered before. A link to that is in the description if you want to check out that after this video. Now, Elon, in his 2016 International Aeronautical Congress meeting, spoke about this type of pressurization here. With both the fuel and oxidizer potentially available to be produced on Mars, the only thing left is to figure out how to repressurize the main tanks during flight. This is where autogenous pressurization comes into play. This is the process which allows a rocket to bring its fuel tanks back up to pressure by utilizing the resources already on board. Nitrogen and helium are the two most common inert gases used for tank pressurization, however, neither is available in abundance on Mars, therefore leaving only two options left, the methane and the oxygen. By heating up the propellants already in the main tanks, SpaceX can generate gaseous methane and oxygen, which can then be pumped back into their respective tanks to repressurize for flight. Autogenous pressurization is especially helpful for long-duration missions to other celestial bodies in the solar system and may actually prove absolutely essential in certain instances such as a Mars mission. Looking deeper into the autogenous pressurization cycle specifically for Starship, we can understand how exactly the liquid propellants can be turned into their gaseous form to repressurize the tanks. But first, let's go through why we need to repressurize the tanks in the first place. Starship is made up of stainless steel, which requires extra reinforcement to support itself. But reinforcement adds weight, right? Which is really not what rocket engineers like. Without structural support, the weight of the heavy ship can cause it to buckle and rupture, as famously demonstrated here by the Atlas Agena. So what other options are there to provide this support? Well, by pressurizing Starship's tanks, two things are accomplished. Firstly, by keeping the main tank structure as rigid as possible, Starship gains the structural support that comes along with that. But secondly, and most relevant to this video, the pressure is also available to push fuel down into the bottom of the tanks and feed propellant into the engines themselves. These factors help show why tank testing is such an important focus of SpaceX's Starship development program as we watch it unfold. The tank section of Starship does not have any extra supporting ribs or stringers running through it, therefore requiring it to be pressurized as long as extensive loads such as fuels, cargo, and crew sit above. The process of autogenously pressurizing the vehicle begins with running the liquid propellants through a heat exchanger sitting directly on the pre-burners of the Raptor engine. Now, Corey here, aka Seabass Productions, has produced some lovely renders to help illustrate this exact process for us, so be sure to check out his channel for more of these amazing videos. Keep in mind that these visuals here are by our understanding of the idea and by no means reflect the real plumbing for those heat exchangers. Now, back to those pre-burners, there are two of them, and they are like mini rocket engines that both run at much higher pressures than the main combustion chamber. One of them runs fuel-rich combustion while the other runs oxygen-rich, which allows for a higher efficiency of combustion in the main chamber when the two mixtures meet together. Now, these visuals here are from Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, so go and check out his channel later as well to learn about topics in a much deeper dive. These propellants that are going into the heat exchanger come from a small feeder pipe running off the main propellant manifold that supplies the pre-burners. The cryogenic liquid propellants are now converted into their gaseous form after being run through a heat exchanger and then can be sent back into their respective tanks. Now, although the propellant is now gaseous, it isn't exactly hot, but rather warmer than the super chilled liquid that it just was. As you can see, the gaseous methane runs up a long repressurant pipe into the top of the methane tank. That methane will then allow the main tank to pressurize. In the exact same way, the gaseous oxygen runs up a slightly shorter pipe into the head of the oxygen tank, therefore pressurizing its main tank. Now, due to each propellant now being in a gaseous state and being much warmer than the rest of the cryogenic propellant, they will both cool down in their respective tanks and eventually condense back into their liquid forms. Now, as it does this, it also very slightly warms up the rest of the propellant in the tanks, and they further expand to continue pressurizing the tanks as well. With heating up cryogenic propellant using the engines and the indirect warming up of propellant in the tanks through thermal equilibrium, a consistent level of pressurization can be maintained throughout the flight. But one major problem does exist, which is that that engine must be running for autogenous pressurization to work, as heat is needed to heat up the propellant. To circumvent this, one idea could be that Starship in orbit would orient its heat shield side to face the sun, therefore allowing the propellant to expand at a very slow rate under indirect heat. As we saw with the Starship flight of SN8 and SN9, SpaceX is continuously getting better at transferring propellant into the header tanks and keeping it nice and chilled during that flight. SpaceX is also likely in the process of producing an actively cooled system to ensure that the header tanks are kept chilly during the long duration missions. So yes, let's shift gears and look at some of the past vehicles that demonstrated autogenous pressurization. The most well-known vehicle to use this method was actually the Space Shuttle, the orbiter vehicle that had the three RS-25 Space Shuttle main engines, which used liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen to fuel them. Now, these propellants were stored in the shuttle's orange external tank, and by running the liquid hydrogen in flight through the RS-25 main combustion chamber via custom grooved pipes and channels, autogenous pressurization can take place as the propellant is heated up by the combustion gases. The now gaseous hydrogen would then be sent back into the external tank to effectively repressurize the vehicle while it was in flight, just as Starship hopes to complete as well. Now, as you might be thinking by now, what about the liquid oxygen? Well, it's a similar process, and it would instead run through a heat exchanger built into the oxygen preburner, which would then be repiped into the external tanks through the external pressurant lines. These 5-inch external lines can be seen next to the main 17-inch liquid oxygen feed pipe. Together with both the liquid hydrogen and the liquid oxygen being heated up by the engines during the flight, the external tank could maintain proper fuel flow without any helium or nitrogen for pressurizing the tanks in flight, which of course saved valuable payload mass. Now, saying all of that, while on the ground, the shuttle's external tank would be kept under pressure by helium, which was supplied via the ground support equipment. The space shuttle's main engines would also utilize helium from the ground equipment to ignite, and then would continue in flight via the autogenous pressurization system. Now, this next example isn't exactly a past vehicle, but I did think it was worth mentioning here as it uses nearly an identical system as the Space Shuttle's external tank. The Space Launch System, or the SLS, will also conduct tank pressurization in flight by autogenously pressurizing the tanks. Once again, the process is nearly the exact same as the Space Shuttle. The Space Launch System, however, won't have as much of the complexity with its vehicle-to-tank interfaces and should be much easier to handle while on the ground, and especially in flight as well. The SLS core stage, just like the shuttle, will have that massive oxygen feed line running down the leeward or the non-wind facing side. The same two repressurant lines will also be located there next to that main feed line. As with the shuttle, helium via the ground equipment would pressurize the vehicle before launch. SLS, with this configuration, is slightly easier to work with as the engine pod is directly connected to the main tanks and no longer separated by a secondary interface. Putting these two together, we'll see shuttle's legacy hardware from the 80s supporting the super heavy lift launch capability in the space launch system of today, a truly amazing feat of engineering. Now, the final vehicle that we're going to cover from the past is the Titan II Intercontinental Ballistic Missile, and later the Titan II Gemini launch vehicle. This vehicle was the successor to the American Mercury program and the precursor to the Apollo moon landing program. Now, that means that this vehicle was operational back in the 60s. That is amazing, right? But the Titan II differed from the other launches as it used hypergolic propellants. These types of propellants are normally stored at room temperature, and upon contact of both the fuel and the oxidizer, both will spontaneously combust together. This allows for reliable combustion within the main chamber and the turbopump cycles without the high risk concern over engine ignition and engine failure. Similar to the other systems that we've just covered, a pressurant line would run up the side of the vehicle and would constantly be adding high pressure gas from the engine's turbopump into the top of each respective propellant tank. The the beginning of the space race really brought up some amazing technologies that have stuck with us right up until today. Now, hopefully you all found that interesting, because before this video, I didn't know that SLS and Space Shuttle used that same method of pressurization as Starship is intending to. Now, this level of engineering never fails to surprise me and constantly reinvigorates my love for all things space. So, as I stated earlier, we're going to find out how Raptor engine starts can happen on other celestial bodies within our solar system. In reality, this is a fairly lengthy process to explain, so I'll instead be cutting it down to make it a little more simplified. Now, none of this is confirmed by Elon Musk or SpaceX, but it's generally what may happen nonetheless. As we know, the major places Starship plans to travel in the next decade mainly includes the Moon and Mars, with possible deep space missions venturing into the asteroid belt. The process for starting a Raptor engine can be designated into three main sections: priming the pre-burner turbines, igniting the pre-burner, and lighting the main combustion chamber. Now, just remember that most of this is unconfirmed and going off our observations and our understanding of the engine and vehicle as they are right now. So we'll first start with the top of the engine and look at how the turbines will be started. As you can see in this render by Corey once again, the liquid methane pre-burner has a small pressurant line coming from the skirt of the Starship, which houses the COPVs with high pressure gases. A COPV, of course, is a composite overwrapped pressure vessel, which is capable of holding upwards of 350 atmospheres on average. Those COPVs store some of that autogenous pressurized gaseous propellant in them for later use and engine starts. So as that methane pressurant line is opened, super pressurized gas is sent into them, spinning up the turbine and then allowing for the methane to flow into the pre-burner and begin. We see the exact same thing happening here on the liquid oxygen side, as the pressurant line sends in oxygen gas from the COPVs. Now, that super high pressure allows the turbine blades to spin extremely fast and begin drawing in propellant to begin the pre-burner combustion. So you may be wondering now why it is called a pre-burner. Well, it's called that because that's exactly what it's named for. It pre-burns the propellant so that when it enters the main combustion chamber, it can be mixed with a higher efficiency and control. Now that the turbines are spinning fast, the might of the Raptor can begin being heard. As the pre-burner on the methane side gets going, with a little bit of oxygen also going into it, we can see the first stage of combustion happening. In order for proper combustion to happen, a tad bit of oxygen is going into the methane pre-burner, and the opposite is happening with the methane going into the oxygen pre-burner. Now, at this point, those COPV's high pressure gases are no longer necessary, as the pre-burners themselves are now running through sheer main tank pressure, so the COPV's could just be shut off. Now, both of those pre-burners are started by a spark igniter that is recessed into the head of the pre-burner chamber. The final part to igniting the Raptor engine is to send those pre-burned gases straight into the main combustion chamber. This is possibly the most simple part of the process, although SpaceX did have to design their own alloy in-house to handle those extremely hot oxygen-rich gases. At this point, another set of spark igniters light the two pre-burned gases in the main combustion chamber, allowing them to combine and complete full-flow stage combustion. What SpaceX has achieved with the Raptor engine is borderline unimaginable. They are the only people to make a full-flow stage combustion cycle engine that has actually flown. I mean, just listen to that roar of the engine on the stand at their McGregor, Texas test facility. It is truly a remarkable achievement. So yes, putting everything together, what do you think? Autogenous pressurization systems seem to be the way to go for those long-duration missions moving forward, but there are always a few drawbacks. The only alternative to this problem would be to revert to the traditional helium-based systems like what's used for the Falcon 9, but that is clearly what SpaceX hopes to avoid. We saw SN8's landing attempt go awry due to the loss of header tank pressure, as tweeted by Elon Musk. Could it have been possible that an issue related to the autogenous pressurization system failed in that vehicle? It may be difficult for Starship to incorporate this method of pressurization during the incredible skydiving or belly flop phase of the flight, but as we know, if anyone can do it, it will be SpaceX. With NASA's involvement in the Starship program throughout the Lunar Starship contract, it's possible that SpaceX can leverage that partnership and pull ideas from the space shuttle to enhance their own pressurant system. Now, I want to hear your thoughts on this idea. Is autogenous pressurization too difficult to achieve in the long term over long missions, or is it the best plan moving forward for SpaceX's long-term goals? As always, let me know in the comments, and if this video has piqued your interest, please do subscribe and like the video. It all helps with the YouTube algorithm. A huge thanks as well to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Over the last few years, we've seen a huge increase in the number of users learning online and doing away with outdated and slow forms of educational content. If you are interested in topics such as we frequently cover, you can get stuck right into this course here to form a solid understanding of the rocket equation. This classical mechanics course will kick off at the ground level with wonderfully detailed and interactive puzzles throughout. Start off understanding the basics of matter in motion, and before you know it, you'll have progressed right up to the rocket equation and be understanding at a deeper level how thrust in one direction causes that equal and opposite reaction. You can also learn all about Newton's law of gravity and crack open the universe of consequences that spring from that. Brilliant's thought-provoking math, science, and computer science content helps guide you to mastery by taking complex concepts and breaking them up into smaller, understandable chunks. You'll start by having fun with interactive course components, and before you know it, you'll be amazed at what you've learned. Thank you very much to Brilliant for their support of my channel here, and if you would like to help support me and would like to give it a try, go to brilliant.org/Marcus House. The first 200 people will get 20% off the first year of Brilliant Premium. The link is in the description below. A big thanks to my amazing patrons and YouTube members here as well. There is no way that we can continue creating content at this frequency and length without you. The support that you all here provide allows us to increase the time that we can spend, and that is all thanks to the growing list of supporters that we see right here. Thank you to each and every one of you. As support increases, that helps the entire team. So if you like what we're doing and you'd like to join our awesome patrons here, head to patreon.com/MarcusHouse, or alternatively, you can join up as a YouTube member as well. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can also have your names listed right here, like all of these other incredible people, and you can have earlier access to the videos to watch before anyone else. Thanks as well to the production crew assisting greatly with the video production, and of course the quality control squad here for helping me research and proof all the material for these videos. If you're interested in these topics and you'd like to be a part of it, follow me on Twitter as well. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video talking about Starship's future ability to refuel in orbit. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTube has selected from a channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.